I want to welcome you to the Bible study today, and we're going to look again at Romans 10 and verse 13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And I realize we are being a little repetitious because we just spoke on this topic the other day, but really I thought it important to emphasize by repetition this great truth. The Lord himself says, whosoever will, let him come and take of the water of life freely. And he says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So if the Lord gives an invitation, and is that not what we believe, that this is the word of God? This is not just the teachings of Paul. This is not just the teachings of biblical characters, but this is, in truth, the word of God. Paul told the Thessalonians, he said, you received it as it was in truth, the preaching. He said, you received it as it was in truth, the words of God. And so, if the Lord says, whosoever will, if the Bible says that Jesus is the light that lighteth every man that cometh into the world, who are we to scratch at the will or poke around at the will and try to inform God about what man is? God knew what man was when he came and died. And when we talk about foreknowledge, predestination is not wrapped up in foreknowledge. If the Lord says, whosoever will, let him come, then what need have we to argue about the will or the disposition of the will? There's no question that that's ridiculous. So what we really need to think about is the fact that most people, if you lined them up and made them make a wise choice and say, would you rather go to heaven or hell? Of course, most people who were giving a serious response would say, well, of course, I want to go to heaven. But just wanting to go to heaven rather than going to a torturous hell is not enough to get you saved. You must hear the gospel. You must hear it preached. You must believe it. And you must put your faith in the Lord. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation. Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. And so you must be accepting of the truth of the gospel. You must hear it, believe it, and call on him to be saved. And if he gives you that invitation, and if, as John 1 says, he is the light that lighteth every man that cometh into the world, when the gospel is presented and a person believes it and receives it, as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. Who are we to say, well, you're not worthy because you did it this way, or you're not worthy because it was done that way? Listen, if you heard the word of truth, Ephesians chapter 1, which also talks about predestination, by the way, if you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and you believed, and you were obedient to the direction of the Holy Spirit, which says, call on the name of the Lord, if you heard, believed, and followed that gospel that was presented to you in obedience and called on the name of the Lord, you are saved. And you didn't do that of your own will. You didn't just decide, hey, there's a heaven up there, there's a hell down there. I want to go to heaven. I don't want to go to hell, so I'm just going to go to heaven. I'm saved. Nobody believes that way. I've never heard anybody, non-Calvinist Baptist, teach that. Nobody teaches that. I think that the Reformed theologians or the Sovereign Grace theologians would have you believe that that's what us Arminians believe, although hardly anybody in the Baptist movement even knows what an Arminian is or looks like or believes. It's certainly not what Baptists are. That's certainly not what whosoever will proponents believe. If you hear the gospel, if you believe the gospel, then you can come to the Lord. And that whosoever will believe, is the people that God foreknew. And foreknowledge, listen, there's no proof for predestination in foreknowledge. Just because I know a thing is going to happen, and God knew that people would believe on his son, he didn't say, I knew John or Jack or Bill would believe. And so what if he did know? That's not what he's talking about. Foreknowledge of God was there was a group of people that make up the church who would believe on his son. God knew those people. He foreknew them, and he died for them. He died for those people that would believe in him. But he died for the whole world. He lit the whole world. He presented the gospel to the world, and he said, whosoever will, let him come. Me having foreknowledge about a thing does not force it to happen. If I know there's going to be church tonight, something could happen to cause us not to go to church tonight, and that is not a declaration of what God's will was one way or the other. I can plan to come to church tonight, and the building could be blown down. I could plan on coming to church tonight, and the whole state could be blown away. I could be planning on going to church tonight, but I could die. But if before I got to church tonight, I heard the truth and believed the truth and called on the Lord to save me, he would. And he would do that for any believer. He would do that for any believer. So when we're talking about predestination, you're talking about believers being predestinated to be conformed to his image. The adoption, the redemption of this body. That's what you're predestinated to. Predestination is eternal security. Foreknowledge is just foreknowledge. I knew what was going to happen. I knew some were going to reject, and I knew some were going to believe. And so what if he knew their individual names? So what? Knowing a thing is going to happen does not mean that it has to happen. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. And that's why the Lord says to Jerusalem, he said, I would have gathered you many times, but you would not. Now you can twist those things and make them say whatever you want to say, but that's what it says, and that's the truth. We have a great God who died for us and presented us with the opportunity. And if God gives us the truth and lets us make that decision and lets us make that choice, then it's not his will that's being overcome. It's our future that's being set. And it's we can then be judged over that because we set our decisions and our future all by ourselves. It's proof. If we accept Christ, it's proof that we have faith in Christ. If we deny Christ, it's proof that we are worthy for the judgment that we would receive for that. As it says in the book of Revelation, they received certain damnation and certain judgment because they were worthy. Prove they were worthy to be destroyed in that manner. They rejected Christ as their Savior. Each man is going to stand before God and give an account for the deeds done in his body. And that goes for believers and non-believers. But it is something that must certainly take place in the life of each and every person. Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins. Do you believe it? Do you disbelieve it? Do business with God on that account, and he will hear you cry. If you call on him, he will save you. Thanks for joining us today. We'll see you next time.